So, hey, good morning, everyone. Today is fifth Sunday, so yes, kids, you are staying in here just so you get a touch of what regular adult services. So we always do it on fifth Sunday, but I do music with the minister on that day as well. But it is called Holy Water. It is by the band We the Kingdom. And the interesting thing of this band is it's actually a family band. So it's two brothers, and then one of the brothers is his three children that are in it as well. But today's song, Holy Water, it focuses on forgiveness and understanding the beauty of God's forgiveness. So, Chuck, go ahead and get that plan, and then I'll come back up. So that is Holy Water by We the Kingdom. And what I'm going to do now is we'll just kind of walk through the lyrics and the theme of this song, and kind of walk through it and add some scripture to it and kind of go through the theme. What I'm going to use is the 51st Psalm, which is the psalm that David writes, is kind of a key text But it's a psalm David writes when he has the whole huge mess with Bathsheba. If you don't know what all that is, just go find it in your Bibles and 1 Samuel and stuff of David's whole mess with Bathsheba. But after he blows and destroys his entire life up, he then writes the 51st Psalm, which is him regretting everything he's done because it's kind of been brought to the forefront of him. He actually has remorse for it. And so we're going to walk through that because everything he says in the 51st Psalm, I think, matches up with what we see in this song. Okay? So here we go. Now, the beginning of this song jumps right into what the effects of sin is in our lives. And what sin does in our lives is when it's in our lives, it presents kind of a distance between us and God. It makes us feel as if a distance has been created between where God is and where we are. That's what sin does. The song says it like this. It says, God, I'm on my knees again. God, I'm begging you, please again. I need you. Oh, I need you. It says, walking down these desert roads, which is, they're kind of implying desert roads, meaning I'm distant from God. I'm just kind of on my own. It says, water for my thirsty soul. I need you. Oh, I need you. You see, sin literally steals our ability to experience joy in our lives. And that is what our enemy's desire is. In John 10:10, Jesus says it this way. He says, a thief's purpose is to steal, kill, and destroy. That Satan's entire purpose of your life is to steal, kill, and destroy, to rob you of any joy and experiencing the joy of God in your life. And we can feel the result of this distance in the words of what David says here in the 51st Psalm. Here's what he says in the first three verses. He says, have mercy on me, O God, because of your unfailing love. Because of your great compassion, blot out the stains of my sin. Wash me clean from my guilt. Purify me from my sin. For I recognize my rebellion. It haunts me day and night. So what you have from David here is David's recognizing when this is brought to the forefront of his life that, man, I have drifted away from you, God, and I need your grace again. You to forgive me. I need your love again. And you get a sense of this guy who feels like he's being haunted because he feels like he's created a huge gap between his relationship with him and God at this point, that he has distanced himself from God. Now, no matter who we are, unresolved sin is in our lives. Okay, so it plays out in several different ways that we have unresolved sin. For some of you, it's very easy to see because your sin is noticeable to everybody else. The sin you participate in, everyone else can see and be like, oh, I see what's going on there. It's easy to identify. For others of you sitting here, some of your unresolved sin is hidden because you've learned really good at disguising it or doing it behind closed doors. So not many people know about it, and it's something only a very few people in a group that know. For others of us, our unresolved sin is an internally thing that's contained inside, and the only people that know about it is God and you. But you know the thoughts you have, you know the things going through your heads, and you know you and God know, and that still creates that distance because you know that sin is there. And finally, some of our unresolved sin is simply the sin of omission, which is where we don't do what we know God is calling us to do, and we just do our own thing. And that one, we pretend a lot of times, doesn't really count because I'm not really doing anything bad, I'm just not doing good, all right? But that's still unresolved sin, and that still creates a distance between you and God and how you feel in your relationship to him. But all sin has a negative result in our lives, and it helps, it makes us lose that feeling of intimacy that we can have with God. But this song shifts to the solution to the sin issue. It presents us with the ability to start over, to wipe our past away, to start fresh, and to actually have a new hope for the future, even though we've had sin in our lives. And here's how the song says it. It says, dead man walking, a slave to sin. I want to know about being born again. I need you. Oh God, I need you. It says, so take me to the riverside. Take me under, baptize. I need you. Oh God, I need you. So what this song does here is it kind of presents baptism as the avenue to restoration and renewal. The way we are restored, the way we have renewal in our lives is it starts at baptism. And here's just a couple of scriptures talking about that. In 1 Peter chapter 3, Peter says, and that water is a picture of baptism, which now saves you, not by removing dirt from your body, but as a response to God from a clean conscience. So what Peter is saying is, you're not baptized to clean up your body by any means. Baptism does is at that point, it gives you a clear conscience. It allows you to know that your sins of your past are no longer yours, and you are free from them. and you don't have to feel guilty about them when you come before God. You don't have to deal with them anymore when you come before God, that you can have a clear conscience before God through that process of baptism, which then carries on as believers, a consistent thing that we have where we can ask for forgiveness for our sins. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says this, "This means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone, and the new life has begun." David talks about this forgiveness this way in verses 7 through 11 in Psalm 51. Here's what he says. He says, "Purify me from my sins, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Oh, give me back my joy again. You have broken me, now let me rejoice. Don't keep looking at my sin. Remove the stain of my guilt. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a loyal spirit within me. Do not banish me from your presence, and don't take your Holy Spirit from me." You see, baptism is where we find forgiveness and grace. It's a beautiful thing when we find forgiveness and grace. And here's the thing. The reason it's so beautiful is the forgiveness that we experience through Jesus in a relationship with him is unlike any other forgiveness we'll find in any other relationship in our lives. And let me explain why they are completely different. The forgiveness that we experience in a human relationship. So let's say me and Rick had an issue and I offended Rick. When Rick forgives me, what he basically is telling me is I'm not going to hold that against you anymore, that we're going to move beyond that point and I'm not going to hold it against you anymore. But there's still lingering repercussions to that sin that I committed towards Rick. And it's simply this. Even though he forgave me, whenever he sees me, he still knows I'm the one that committed that sin against him. Even if he's forgiven me, he doesn't think Rick did it to him or Bonnie did it to him or Kevin did it to him. He knows I was the one that did that, okay? And so as wonderful as forgiveness can be between two humans, we still have the stain of knowing that that person did this to me, even if I've allowed myself to release them from it and move beyond it. The beauty of God's forgiveness is this, is that in a relationship with Jesus, our sins are forgiven in the sense that God moves beyond them and he lets them go and he no longer treats us in accordance with how we sinned against him. But the other side of this is this, that God doesn't see your face on that sin anymore, okay? He sees Jesus's face on it. So when he sees that sin, he sees Jesus doing it, not you. And so you don't even have that stain of the sin there anymore. You are completely, totally, 100% forgiven, where God never even recognizes you did that sin in your life. It's now Jesus' responsibility, and it's now on him, and so you could be forgiven. Does that make sense? That is the drastic difference between forgiveness between people and our forgiveness we find in our relationship with Jesus Christ. David describes his forgiveness and grace this way. Here's how he says it in Psalm 51. He says, "Forgive me for shedding blood, O God, who saves. Then I will joyfully sing of your forgiveness. Unseal my lips, O Lord, that my mouth may praise you." He says in Psalm 32, "Oh, what joy for those whose disobedience is forgiven, whose sin is put out of sight. Yes, what joy for those whose record the Lord has cleared of guilt, whose lives are lived in complete honesty." David's going, in God's forgiveness, your sin is gone. Okay, it never existed on your record to start with. That's how God's forgiveness works. In 1 John, it says it like this, "But if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all wickedness." That we are totally free of our sins. The song says it like this, "Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey to my lips." So the song here is trying to describe how incredible God's grace and God's forgiveness is to us. And it says, "Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey to my lips." Now, if you don't like honey, that's not a good thing to you. But if you see honey here, it's just saying it's something sweet. It's something that you relish. It's something that's beautiful to you. It says, "Like the sound of a symphony to my ears," something beautiful to my ears, "like holy water on my skin." Okay? So the song tries to describe the beauty of God's forgiveness when we experience in our lives. Because when you really understand God's forgiveness and his grace, it's an incredible concept and truth to us. And it will change your life if you truly understand what it means and the significance of it to your life. This life-changing understanding of God's forgiveness and grace should have lasting impact on our lives as we live it out day in and day out. Because here's the thing, if you see the concept of God's grace and his forgiveness and you see righteous living, and what the best way I can describe righteous living is this, a desire to put God's needs in front of yours, okay? That you want to please God instead of just pleasing yourself. If you see that concept of righteous living as simply a rule book or a religious activity, so your relationship with God is just rules he's given you, or it's a religious thing you do to kind of feel good about yourself, if that's how you view righteous living, all God's forgiveness and grace is kind of like an escape ticket to get out of some trouble from time to time. And you will use God's grace as kind of an escape hatch and go, man, I just messed up, but hey, you know what? God forgives. God forgive me. And you'll be like, cool, I'm forgiven. And it's just an escape hatch to you. The difference is this. When you understand what real forgiveness and real grace is through a relationship with God, our lives no longer are about what makes me happy or what will benefit me the most. What happens is your mind starts to have a shift. And the shift that starts happening in your mind is you start trying to figure out, how do I please God? How do I not hurt God because I know what it costs for the forgiveness and grace that I've received? How do I shift that mindset that I have and go, it's not about me anymore, it's about God. So I'm looking to please him and I'm looking not to hurt him. The song says it like this, and this is my favorite part of the song. It says, I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. Okay? What we see here is this. Love is a very powerful motivating factor. What the song's basically saying is the authors of this are going, God, I don't want to abuse your grace by taking it for granted. I don't want to use it as just an escape ticket. I don't want it as a get out of free jail card in Monopoly. I don't want to treat it that way and treat it so just like it's a minor little thing that I can throw around. What he's saying here is, I don't want to abuse your grace. I need it every day. It's the only thing that makes me want to change. When you understand what provided you that grace, you start to understand, I don't want to sin anymore. I don't want to offend God anymore. I don't want to hurt God like that anymore. And it changes your perspective of why you're trying to live a righteous life. Instead of it being a religious activity, it becomes about a love relationship with Jesus Christ. And that changes everything. Psalms 51. David says it like this. He says, you do not desire a sacrifice or I would offer one. So after he realizes everything and he realizes he broke this relationship with God and he's asking for his grace and his forgiveness, he says at the very end of it, he says, you don't desire a sacrifice. Like, you don't desire me to go give a sacrifice or I would offer one. He says, you do not want a burnt offering. The sacrifice you desire is a broken spirit. You will not reject a broken and repentant heart. Oh God. So David realizes here, God, you're just not looking for me to go burn some new thing and be like, I messed up. Let me go give a sacrifice. He's going, what I want from you is I want a broken heart. I want you to understand the sin you just committed, it hurt me, meaning God. It hurt him as well. And I want you to understand that because when you understand you're hurting God and his spirit, when you sin, it changes your perspective on what you're doing. If all it is, again, is religion, we'll go sin all day long because I can just ask for forgiveness whenever I want and there's no consequences to it. When I realize Jesus is going to be held accountable for my sin, it changes how I go about my life. Okay? The other scripture here from Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30, it says this, and do not bring sorrow on God's Holy Spirit by the way you live. Remember, he has identified you as his own, guaranteeing that you will be saved on the day of redemption. So what we're being told here by Paul in Ephesians there is he's going this, don't live your life in a way that brings sorrow to the Holy Spirit, where the Holy Spirit is crying over the life you're living. And he's talking specifically to Christians here, and he's going, don't live it in a way that you continually hurt the Holy Spirit. Don't treat God's grace that way. That was not what it was ever intended for. God's grace was intended so you understood how much he loved you so that you would love him back. And then you would start a relationship built on love, not on rules. And you know that is two drastically different things. If you were a child, how many of you would say you grew up in a household where your love is, it was just rules, obey the rules all the time? Did anyone grow up in those? Okay, a few of you did. It's an unloving environment, is it not? It's just follow the rules, everything's rules, and you don't learn how to love, all right? And God's going, I don't want that in our relationship. I don't want to be a bunch of rules to you. I want you to understand my forgiveness and grace, and I want you to learn to love me because I'm going to show you how much I love you. And through that, we can have a different type of relationship, one that's built on love rather than religion. And so when we understand God's forgiveness and grace and truly understand what's happening, that starts to develop in our lives. So I'm just going to close with saying this. Church, live well, okay? Remember the forgiveness and grace that is found in our relationship with God and let it transform your life on a daily basis. Be the people God has called you to be, not because he's just called you to do it, but because you love him. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father,